coming up on the March 31st edition of Sports Xtra. The Tar Heels are elite. The women's basketball team pushes out a gritty upset win against number one seed South Carolina. Is a Final Four in the Heels' future?
The men's basketball season came to an early end, but it was a roller coaster thrill ride. We take a look back at the pulse-pounding action of the season.
And UNC football players show off their skills for NFL scouts. Did they take a step in the right direction? All that and more.
Sports Xtra starts right now.
From the University of North Carolina School of Journalism and Mass Communication, covering the full range of Tar Heel athletics, this is Sports Xtra.
The NCAA tournament is coming down to the wire on both the men's and women's side, and only one team from the state of North Carolina is still standing. Welcome to Sports Xtra. I'm Delia D'Ambra.
And I'm Allie Massione. Before we get to that, though, we have to discuss some possible huge changes in the college sporting world. The National Labor Relations Board in Chicago has ruled that Northwestern University football players are employees and can unionize. This landmark decision could be the beginning of a complete breakdown of the student-athlete system. Luis Fernandez joins us live now from the Old Well to discuss what this could mean for the future of UNC and the NCAA.
Thanks, Allie. You know, the National Labor Relations Board in Chicago, their decision to allow Northwestern football team to unionize, it is, like you said, quite monumental. Now, the players still have to vote, so, you know, they may choose not to, but given the leadership of former Northwestern quarterback Cain Coulter, you have to assume that they'll say yes. Northwestern University themselves have said that they plan on appealing the decision by the board. Now, it could take a matter of a few months, a few years even, and given the lawsuits that could occur afterwards, it could be quite some time before we realize what the result of this is. Now, the reason why this is important is because of the precedent that it could establish. If Northwestern's football team is allowed to unionize, that gives every private university in the entire country the legal justification to unionize as well. Some public universities, they aren't so lucky. For example, North Carolina law says that UNC would not be able to create a union for their football team. Looking at that more practically, that's if, let's say, Duke and UNC were going after the same player, Duke could pay that player for their time. UNC, they could not. That's a huge competitive advantage. Now, if you look at some of the other schools are reacting to this, they've said that if their football team were to create a union, they might just drop them off of their program in general. It's really quite a Pandora's box situation for the NCAA. Now, regardless of what happens over the next few years, we're going to see what the future holds for the NCAA and for college sports in general. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Luis. That was Luis Fernandez joining us live from the Old Well.
Students often head to the UNC's Board of Trustees meetings to air grievances or hear what's going on at Carolina. On Thursday, student athletes came to the meeting at the Carolina Inn to address the trustees regarding how they're prepared to do college-level work. Athletes from several UNC teams came to discuss the perception of student athletes on campus. They wanted board members to know that UNC athletes work hard on their academic careers and can't all be clumped together and considered illiterate. Basketball star Marcus Page said he knows his teammates were better than that in the classroom.
I know all my teammates. I've been in study hall with them, and trust me, we all can read and write. We take pride in what we do academically. Our basketball program always has. Coach Williams has a great track record with that, and he will continue to do that.
At a faculty meeting Friday, Provost Jim Deed said the results of an outside investigation of whistleblower Mary Willingham's data about some athletes' reading levels will most likely be released sometime this week. The broader investigation by attorney Kenneth Wangstein continues.
The women's basketball team is far from home, but the Heels are playing like they're in Carmichael Arena, taking on the number one seeded South Carolina Sunday night in the Sweet 16. It wasn't an easy game for freshman phenom Diamond DeShield. She went out twice with injuries during the first half, but that didn't stop her. She returned to score a team-high 19 points. Freshman forward Stephanie Mavunga also put some points on the board, scoring 13 to lead the Heels to a 65-58 victory against top-seeded South Carolina. The Gamecocks got within a point in the second half, but the real Carolina led from start to finish. The Heels move on to play Stanford Tuesday night on the Cardinals' home court. Assistant sports editor for the DTH, Grace Rayner, is traveling with the team. I spoke with her earlier today about the Heels' impressive run in the tournament.
I think it was really good for UNC to be able to prove that they could kind of contend with the top seed. The really obvious thing is that UNC is going to be playing against Stanford at Stanford, and so they're going to have a really crazy environment. Yesterday when they beat Penn State by 25. The place was essentially sold out. It was crazy, and UNC always says that they play better on the road, but I think tomorrow is going to be the true test of that, to come in here and to have to play them on their home turf. The team, I think that UNC kind of goes up and goes down with Diamond to Shield, and so I think that if Diamond plays well and if she's healthy, you know, yesterday she twisted her ankle and then she kind of re-injured an already pre-existing knee injury. But she went back out there and scored 19 points. So I think that if she is on her game and is, you know, ready to compete, then I think UNC can win. I think that Stanford right now, based on the press conference that I went to, is paying a lot of attention to Diamond to Shields. And so I think if they collapse on her, that's going to leave some opportunities open for Alicia Gray to shoot from the corner. Zelina McDaniel will do some things in the post. And so I think that if they can really spread the ball, then they're going to be successful. Their offenses are totally different. The two teams are totally opposite. But I think that if Diamond plays well and if they play well in transition, then they should be fine.
That was Grace Rayner reporting from Stanford, California.
Carolina sporting events are often a fun place to come together and cheer on the Tar Heels. But what would happen if a lockdown occurred in the midst of a game? Brett Thompson takes us inside the security protocol during campus sporting events.
It was around 4:25 p.m. when students received this text from Alert Carolina. At this point, the Lady Tar Heels trailed UT Martin by 15 early in the second half of their first round NCAA tournament game here at Carmichael Arena.
The text notified students of an armed and dangerous man on campus. Assistant Athletics Director for Operations Ellen Kohler says Carmichael officials were prepared.
Fortunately, we've been working with the same folks for lots of years. We've done a fair amount of training, Homeland Security, Secret Service, tabletops. The wonderful thing is the trust that this group has with one another.
During the lockdown, Carmichael officials locked all entrances and exits to the arena. To avoid panic, there was no PA announcement until an all-clear was given with less than a minute left in the Tar Heels' come-from-behind victory.
There was fear of panic from everyone in the arena. We were concerned about not necessarily panic, but a rush to leave.
Fortunately for spectators and teams, the game was indoors at Carmichael Arena. But what if this happened during an outdoor sport such as football or baseball?
We would have to now figure out the best protocol to address that. Do we have a direct line from Boshmer or Fetzer Field into public safety?
Despite the rarity and intensity of these situations, Kohler assures us of UNC's number one priority.
Bottom line, the safety of everyone in the arena is the only thing that mattered that day and would matter moving forward.
Carolina officials can now use this experience to further ensure spectators a fun and safe environment at athletics events. From Chapel Hill, I'm Brett Thompson reporting.
Even with all the action and success the women's team is having, we here at Sports Xtra miss the men's team dearly. No worries, our own Ryan O'Rourke gives us a look back into the roller coaster ride that was the Tar Heels men's basketball season.
Like a swinging vine, swing my heart across the line. In my face is flashing signs. Seek it out and ye shall find. Old, but I'm not that old. Young, but I'm not that bold. And I don't think the world is sold. I'm just doing what we're told. I feel something so right. Doing the wrong thing. And I feel something so wrong. Doing the right thing. Everything that kills me makes me feel alive. I've been losing sleep, dreaming about the things that we could be. I've been playing hard, said no more counting dollars, we'll be counting stars.
Take that money, watch it burn. Sing it with the best of our love. Take that money, watch it burn.
Tar Heel fans can look forward to seeing more highlights from UNC's number 5 because Marcus Page has announced he will return for his junior season.
With just more than half of the spring practices in the books, the UNC football team took to a road trip to Charlotte to show fans how the Heels have progressed. The offense struggled a bit early on, no surprise, because the season is just getting started. This scrimmage was meant to help the team gain some experience, especially the younger guys playing in front of a big crowd for their first time as Tar Heels. Star running back recruit Elijah Hood showed his scrappiness up the middle with this powerful and punishing run. In the end, road scrimmages like this help to extend the recruiting range of the team, especially in a city like Charlotte, where many of the guys in the 2014 recruiting class come from. And speaking of Charlotte, the Carolina Panthers were one of the 51 NFL teams represented at UNC's Pro Day recently, as former Carolina football players tried to impress the scouts. Nicole Comparato has the story.
What if a scout from every NFL team in the country was watching you? No pressure, right? UNC's NFL Pro Day featured 13 players who think they're ready to take it to the next level, including the highly touted Eric Ebron, who was enjoying the attention.
Yeah, everything went great. Two drops, no biggie. You know, it happens. You know, Jerry Rice even drops passes. No, I'm just kidding. But I just went out there and I tried and did my best. And hopefully, you know, I wowed the scouts.
The other players were thinking the same thing as they completed drills, including those players who had early exits this past season due to injuries. The last time quarterback Bryn Renner was on Navy Field was when he announced his season-ending shoulder injury.
You know, I'm at a different state right now. I got a smile on my face and not tearing up as much. So it was just fun to be back on the practice field. And you know, missing those 5 games really hurt, but it also motivated me.
Pro Day lasted around 4 hours as scouts and team reps worked individually with the players.
When it was all said and done, one of the most impressive performances was that of tight end Eric Ebron, which doesn't surprise anybody. But I did hear some NFL analysts behind me saying that they think he solidified himself as a top 10 draft pick today.
And though Ebron says he has no idea when he'll be drafted, he's already got a plan for that special moment.
Jump up out the chair, fix my tie, and walk to that stage and put on my hat.
Nothing but enjoying the many sets of eyes on him once again. This time as he joins the NFL. In Chapel Hill, I'm Nicole Comparato.
That was Nicole Comparato reporting. In the next month, leading up to the draft, many of the players will stay in Chapel Hill for workouts, so you might be seeing them around.
The women's lacrosse team has a lot of great players, but one pair really stands out.
You might have to look twice at these Carolina athletes when Sports Xtra returns.
Connect with us online by liking the Sports Xtra Facebook page and following us on Twitter at @SportsXtra_UNC.
Hey, look at mommy.
Maybe the light hurts his eyes.
Maybe she's just not hungry.
Look.
Maybe it's a phase.
Avoiding eye contact is one early sign of autism. Learn the others today.
The next 30 seconds can save you a lot of money. Just do your laundry in cold and stick to full loads. Auto-sleep your computers. Plug your gadgets in a power strip and switch it off when you're done. Head it out, turn back your thermostat by 10 degrees. And drive sensibly. The more energy you save, the more money you save. Find other great tips at energysaver.gov.
Now it's time for This Week in Bad Stats.
Bad stats?
Horrible stats. Here goes. 132.
That's how many batters struck out 4 times in 1 game last season.
Wow, very good. Here's a tough one, though. 3-4.
No idea.
That's how many kids witness bullying. 3 out of 4.
That's not a good stat.
No, it's not, but it can change. Kids want to help, but they don't know how. Visit stopbullying.gov and give them the tools they need to help prevent bullying.
There are plenty of safe ways kids can help at stopbullying.gov.
All right, give me a spot. You know my motto, safety first.
They could be dangerous. I think we should call animal control.
Animal control?
To be safe.
Don't worry. I got this. It's a new motto.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
We'll be right back.
Duke swept Carolina baseball in a three-game series in Durham on Sunday. The last time that happened, 1994. Shortstop Michael Russell and second baseman Wood Myers had two hits apiece for Carolina, which dropped its sixth game in a row to fall 5-7 in the ACC. Carolina threatened in the last two innings with Russell's ninth inning fly ball. However, Duke's Nick Hendricks worked the final two innings, giving Duke its first sweep against Carolina in 20 years. UNC looks to get back on track in Bochimer Stadium against UNCW on Tuesday. The women's lacrosse team's highly anticipated matchup against fifth-ranked Northwestern is on hold due to complications as the team tried to travel to Chicago this weekend. Officials rescheduled the match to 4:30 today. A quick update, the Tar Heels are down 2-5 at the half.
Think you're seeing double? Kate Eastman says if you're a Carolina women's lacrosse fan, it's no illusion.
Juniors Lindsay Scott and Sarah Scott, North Carolina women's lacrosse only set of identical twins in history, share the same chromosomes but command different halves of the field. This sister act began on a whim when a friend's dad asked the girls to join a middle school lacrosse team. From that point on, the pair has been inseparable, co-captaining their New York high school team before joining UNC's national championship caliber program. The decision to play for North Carolina wasn't unanimous at first.
She wanted to go to separate schools just because I guess we were maybe a little sick of each other. But so Lindsay always wanted to come here, and so she came by herself on a visit with my parents, and then she was like, you gotta come here, Sarah.
Sarah joined her sister in Chapel Hill and both saw playing time, Sarah as a backup defender and Lindsay as a reserve attacker during their freshman seasons. Although their roommates look identical and have the same interests, they approach the game of lacrosse very differently.
Lindsay's an attacker and she's a lefty, and Sarah's a defender and she's a righty. So they're literally mirror twins. And Sarah's one of our draw special kids. She comes up with every 50-50 ball, every loose ball. So she's really established herself as in that position for us, where Lindsay's more of a scorer. She likes the ball in her stick.
Lindsay and Sarah also say there's a fundamental difference in their personalities.
She's a little sassier.
Okay. We'll say I'm more direct.
The twins have never been separated for longer than 48 hours, but are glad that they play opposite from one another on the field because they're so competitive.
We used to get kicked out of practice in high school. Not kicked out, our coach would threaten to kick us out. So we weren't allowed to play at each other anymore because it would get too aggressive.
The Scots might not be women's lacrosse's solitary set of twins for long, as number one ranked UNC will attempt to add a 2014 national championship trophy to last year's identical hardware. In Chapel Hill, I'm Kate Eastman reporting.
So far in the Tar Heels' undefeated 2014 season, Lindsay Scott has netted 5 goals and 3 assists, while Sarah Scott has scooped up 20 ground balls on the defensive side.
The men's lacrosse team has a tendency to top the hop.
After all, the Heels have taken down John Hopkins 6 of the past 7 times the teams have met up. Saturday was no different as the Heels took to Homewood Field. UNC wearing all blue took an early lead with this quick goal from Joey Sankey. Sankey wasn't done yet though. Into the first quarter, Sankey scores again to tie the game up 3-3. Carolina went into the second half down 5-7, but fights back and regains the lead in the third quarter. Then it just gets ugly as RG Keenan reminds us of last year's OT goal and scores a fast break goal against the Jays to make it 10-7. Now let's just throw one more in for Sankey. Timer's on, UNC's gotta get rid of it, and Sankey dives to give the Heels an even bigger lead. UNC wins this one 13-9.
With so many athletes on campus, UNC's athletic trainers have a big job on their hands.
They're charged with keeping players upright and ready to fight, so it's about time they get some love. Next on Sports Xtra.
If I got to go to college, oh my goodness. I like discovering new things. You get to see what works for you and what doesn't. That helps you evolve as a person. You get to make like a supernova of skill or talent or whatever it is. I've always wanted to go to college. I just feel like that's my destiny. My name is Queen, and I am your dividend.
Adopting a new pet is a rewarding experience. And shelter pets make super pets. Your new best friend will steal your heart, bring you happiness, and enrich your life for years to come. You can make a difference in the life of an animal. Adopt and bring home a shelter pet today. To find out more, visit theshelterpetproject.org.
Michael Adams?
Here.
Michael Adams?
Here.
Michael Adams.
Here!
Michael Adams.
Students who miss 18 days of school in any grade risk falling behind and not graduating. Absences add up. Keep track at boostattendance.org today.
So I've come up with a family emergency plan.
Great. What is it?
It's difficult to talk about, so I'm not telling you.
How will we know what to do?
You won't.
I'm so glad I won't have to remember anything.
And me too. Thanks for this, sweetie.
Talk to your kids about who to call, where to meet, what to pack. Visit ready.gov/kids for tips and information.
Nothing could stop the UNC track and field team this weekend at the Raleigh Relays, not even Mother Nature. Despite the rain, sophomore Lizzie Whelan posted the fourth fastest time in the nation in the 800-meter run. In the field, senior jumper Tristine Johnson walked away with second place in the triple jump finals. And despite trailing most of the race, freshman Corey Nichols blasted off late in the 800 with a PR of 1 minute and 49 seconds, taking first and tying for ninth in the nation. And the Raleigh Relays wasn't the only place where the Heels performed well. Junior Zinnia Ron shined in her first heptathlon in a UNC uniform competing in the Texas Relays in Austin. After her seven events, Ron totaled 5,523 points, just 55 off the school record. That puts her in third in the country and all but guarantees her a spot at the national championships in June.
UNC and Duke athletics teams have a long-standing rivalry, and the scope of that rivalry is growing. Kylan McCoy tells us athletics trainers from the schools are facing off in a friendly competition.
With more than 1,200 likes and shares on Facebook, UNC and Duke are fighting a battle of the athletics trainers. In honor of National Athletic Training Month, trainers from the rival schools are competing in a video contest.
Even though we're rivals on the field or on the court, like, we're still just one profession, so either way we can bring awareness to our profession as a whole is great.
Earlier this month, the UNC athletics trainers made this video for Facebook to demonstrate what they do on a day-to-day basis. The North Carolina Athletic Trainers Association shared the video on social media as part of a month-long contest supporting National Athletic Training Month. So just how important are the athletic trainers? The Stalling Evans Sports Medicine Center provides care, rehabilitation, and athletic training to more than 500 Olympic sport athletes at UNC.
A lot of times we are the first ones on the scene, whether it be at practices or during games. So when someone gets hurt, we are able to respond, treat them effectively, or just in the sense of having someone to do their rehab.
For many athletes at UNC, their athletic trainers are just as important off the field as they are during competition. And getting the athletes fit for competition is only half the battle.
The coaches do what they need to do at practice, but once they come in here, like, it is my goal to make sure that I get them back as quickly and as safely as possible. And then hopefully they're stronger coming back than what they were coming in.
Although National Athletic Training Month is coming to an end, the support the trainers provide for UNC athletes is year-round. In Chapel Hill, I'm Kylie McCoy reporting.
UNC won the Athletic Training Education Program division of the video contest by getting the most likes on Facebook.
The UNC softball team played a doubleheader Sunday at home and struggled in both games against top-ranked FSU. In game one, the Heels simply couldn't get on the board. The Seminoles' offense was rolling, racking up 6 runs on 10 hits, and UNC fell 6-0. The Heels looked to make a comeback in game two, but this ground ball with the bases loaded in the bottom of the 7th halted the UNC comeback, and the Heels lost 5-3. It was the team's first series loss in ACC play and reminded the players of the need to concentrate on the basics.
Oh, I felt like we were very prepared for today. We were excited going into the game. We felt very confident, and I feel like we prepared really well. And they, you know, again, they scored runs. You have to score runs to win a game.
The Heels are now 18-14, 9-4 in the league. Third game of the series against FSU starts in just about half an hour. Basketball? Nope. Soccer? Forget about it.
One Club Sport will really take your breath away when Sports Xtra returns.
Don't forget to tune into our sister shows, Carolina Week at 5 p.m. every Wednesday on Time Warner 24 or Campus Channel 34, and Carolina Connection at 8:30 every Saturday morning on WCHL 97.9 FM.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Ready or not, here I come.
Take time to be a dad today.
Maybe he's really focused.
Hey, Michael. Maybe he likes spinning the wheels.
Maybe he just loves trucks.
Maybe he's just being a boy.
Preoccupation with objects is one early sign of autism. Learn the others today. The sooner it's diagnosed, the better.
So what you want to do is, have you already enrolled?
You're doing fine.
What did that just do?
Select the drop-down menu again.
Okay.
Sign, you're already enrolled.
Oh. Example here, so
don't panic.
You're ready to make your payments.
There it is.
Oh my God!
I really can't believe it. That's awesome.
Good for you.
Foods to the right temperature using a food thermometer. 3,000 Americans will die from food poisoning this year. Keep your family safer. Check your steps at foodsafety.gov.
The NCAA tournament is coming to a close and championship weekend is quickly approaching.
So how's your bracket doing? We invited you and our bracketologist to a bracket challenge, and things are looking good for a select few of our competitors. Luis Fernandez is in first place for the second week in a row. He has Florida taking home the title. Ryan O'Rourke and Evan Badler are right behind him, taking second and third respectively. And we can't all be winners. Everybody's favorite British bracketologist Ben Walsh is in dead last, with only one of his final four teams remaining. Ouch. There are 50 club sports offered at UNC.
I jumped in to take you below the surface to look at one that has no equal.
Ready, set, puck drop? That's right, it's underwater hockey, a globally played pool sport that requires snorkeling gear, fins, a stick, and a lot of physical endurance.
I like how tough it is, because it's a physical challenge, obviously, holding your breath as long as you can, swimming as fast as you can, all while trying to navigate three dimensions, because it's not just left, right, forward, and back, you're also doing up and down.
I even got a chance to try it out, and it was no easy task. Moving the puck just a few inches is one of the hardest skills to master.
It's a couple pounds, so you can't get it very far on your own. It takes a lot of swimming and a lot of hard pushing to get it where you want to go.
Junior Emily Davidson says the game's fast pace is something many people don't expect.
It's the first time you get in, everything is moving so fast. You suddenly just see all these people just like converge on the puck and you're just like, what just happened?
A game is typically played 6-on-6. With so many people in the water, there have to be rules to prevent roughness.
You're gonna bump, you're gonna jostle, but if I just like go spear him into a wall, I'm gonna get in trouble.
Playing fair and having fun is what this sport is all about.
The underwater club hockey team will have an ACC tournament this weekend in Cary.
That does it for this edition of Sports Xtra.
Thanks for watching. Have a good night.